Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we begin the 8th episode of the 18th topic. We have been discussing the Isnad of the 7 canonical reading, which were chosen by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in the 3rd or 4th century. Before we go on to discuss the Isnad of the 5th famous reciter who Abu Bakr had chosen in his own times, and he is Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i, I would like to just make a small recap and a small summary of the previous discussions that have been gone on in a very, very brief manner. Just to summarize the research methodology for us that I had adopted and I had indicated in the very first episode. If you recall, I had said that among the major points that I have followed in this research, in particularly investigating the isnad of the canonical readings, is the first is that since it is claimed that these readings are mutawatir and their isnad have been mentioned in our earliest books on Qiraat, so therefore it is very easy to investigate this claim, whether they are mutawatir or not. And hence I had started this discussion by saying that we will first investigate the upper isnad of these readings, and by upper isnad I meant the reading or the chain of narration or the isnad which goes from from the famous reciter, one of the seven reciters, up to a companion. And if we find tawatur or any semblance of tawatur in this, then we shall go to the lower isnad, which would mean the isnad which goes from a collector or on a book in which this this isnad has been cited, and right up to one of the famous reciters. So, for taking an example, if I, for example, quote the fact that Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in his Kitab al-Sabah has quoted his chain of narration or his isnad from which he got all these seven readings. So the upper isnad, for example, would specify the isnad from one of the reciters, famous reciters, who is Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym, to a companion, and the lower isnad would signify that isnad from Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid to Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym. So if there is any tawatur in the first or the upper isnad, only then will there be any need to discuss the lower isnad, because if a reading is not mutawatir in any section, then whether it is mutawatir in the later sections or the lower section, it does not matter. It has to be classified amongst the ahad. The second principle of note, which I had alluded to, was the fact that in this particular sequence, in this particular isnad, many of the Quran reciters are acting as transmitters of information, or to broadly say, transmitters of hadith. So therefore, when they are transmitting information, then jarh on them shall be entertained, which has been recorded in hadith and rijal books, as well as in qiraat books themselves. This is because they are now not acting in this situation as Quran reciters. They are acting as transmitters of information, for example, telling us who is the teacher of whom, or so on and so forth. So in this case, we shall entertain the jarh on him. This I say because in accordance with the famous principle of our qiraat, the jarh on them is not entertained when they are acting as Quran reciters, and I fully adhere to that. I would not impugn or do jarh on any Quran reciter as long as he is acting as a Quran reciter. But when he is acting as a transmitter of information, then I shall entertain the jarh on him, and I have been doing this all along, and I shall do so also in the remaining discussions. So this is the second important principle, which I must repeat and reiterate, and for your own knowledge, put before you, that it is absolutely essential to realize that the jarh here is not presented in their capacity as Quran reciters, but in their capacity of transmitting information. And conversely, I can also say that whenever a reader is acting as a reader, or a Quran reciter is acting as a Quran reciter, I will not entertain jar on him. The third point of importance, viewers, that I'd like to highlight before you is that if there is no tawseek available or ta'dil available on a particular Quran reciter who is acting as a transmitter of information, then he shall not be regarded as reliable. He has to be consigned to the majhul category, because we do not positively know that he is a person of repute or whether he's a reliable person or not. So these are some of the basic principles which I wanted to just refresh in your memories, so that when we move forward, we can see that I am actually applying these particular principles. Also, viewers, I'd like to just give you a very, very brief summary of the reciters themselves that we have discussed. So the first reciter, viewers, if you would recall, I discussed was Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym, and the teachers of Nafi and the teachers of his teachers are being displayed now in this chart, which has already brought up in the very initial episodes when we were discussing Nafi. However, once I put forth my own critique, I think that this chart or this illustration is further reduced. And as you can see, that in this case, Nafi's only teacher who could be established was Yazid Abu Ja'far Yazid ibn Qarqa. And from him, the only person who could be established as a teacher was Abdullah ibn Ayash ibn Abi Rabia. But from Abdullah ibn Abi Rabia, Abdullah ibn Ayash ibn Abi Rabia, Ubay ibn Ka'b could not be established as his teacher. So you can see from this illustration also that a single strand which supposedly could have remained is also not intact because of the fact that the final person or the final link between the Sahabi and the person who read from him, there we have an inqita, we have a broken chain there. So therefore Nafi's isnad is clearly munkata if this critique that I presented earlier on regarding Nafi is relied upon. Next was the person we discussed, or the second reciter that we discussed, and I had also mentioned this fact that the order in which we are discussing these reciters is the same in which Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid has presented these seven readers. The way he has chosen them and in the sequence that he has mentioned in his own book, it is the same sequence that I have adopted in discussing these readers. So the second person or the second reader that he discussed was Abdullah ibn Kasir, and you can see from the chart before you that if we rely on the accounts of our earliest Qiraat books, then his teachers are being represented in this particular chart, and obviously the teachers of his teachers as well. However, if my critique is presented, then Abdullah ibn Kasir's isnad is reduced to a single strand, and we can see that this single strand is being displayed before you. We have Ubay ibn Ka'b, then we have Abdullah ibn Abbas, and then Mujahid ibn Jabr, and finally from him, Abdullah ibn Kasir, and from Abdullah ibn Kasir, we can see that this reading was transmitted by many of his students. So a single strand remains as far as Abdullah ibn Kasir is concerned. The third qari, or the third reciter, if you recall, that we had discussed was Asim ibn Abu Najud, and you can see his teachers and the teachers of his teachers being displayed before you in the chart above, or the chart that is just before you. Now, if my critique on Asim's teachers and the teachers of his teachers is accepted, then I'm afraid we are reduced to nothing, because none of Asim's teachers are established and none of the teachers of the teachers of Asim are also established. So none of them are established. So we find a case in which Asim's reading right up is from the very start is munqata. Finally, the fourth person we had discussed till now, the fourth reciter, was Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, and you can see that his chart is now being displayed before you, the teachers and the teachers of his teachers right up to the companions, and also very similar to Asim ibn Najud. If my critique is accepted regarding him, then we find that none of his teachers is established, and neither any of the teachers of his teachers is established. So at the very start, his reading to Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat's reading to is absolutely munkata from its very origin. So I just wanted to make this small recap before you, before now we move on to the next narrator. And he is, as I said, Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i, and he is also a reciter of Kufa. Very briefly, some biographical information about Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i is put forth by Az-Zahabi in his Marifat al-Qurra' al-Kibar. He says that he was born in Kufa around 120 Hijra, and Abu Ubaid is reported to have said that he had ikhtiyar in Qiraat, so he chose certain readings of Hamza and abandoned some others. We know Hamza was his teacher, so since he had ikhtiyar, so therefore he chose some of his readings and he gave up or forsook or abandoned some of the others of his teacher. Now, according to Abu Bakr ibn al-Ambari, he was the most competent scholar of Arabic syntax of his times, as well of al-Gharib, and was also a very, very gifted memorizer of the Quran. Now, let me next present before you his teachers who are supported through isnad or through isnad-based content. And these teachers are six in number, as you can see that they are being displayed before you. We have Abban ibn Taghlib, then we have Al-Hajjaj ibn Artha. In the third place, we have Muhammad ibn Abdir Rahman ibn Abi Layla. And in the fourth place, we have Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyad. In the fifth place, we have Isa ibn Umar. And in the sixth place, we have Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. So these are the six teachers who are his teachers based on some isnad that we shall examine as we go along. Let me now also present before you his teachers who are claimed to be his teachers, but we do not have any isnad regarding this, or any isnad which actually corroborates this claim that these are teachers. And these are also, there are in fact eight in number. So we have Abu Ibrahim Ismail ibn Jafar. Then we have Abu As-Salat Az-Zayda ibn Qudama. And by the way, these two have been mentioned by Ad-Dani as Kisai's teachers. And then in the third place, we have Al-Mufazzal ibn Muhammad Al-Dhabi. In the fourth place, we have Muhammad ibn Al-Hasan ibn Abi Sara. Then we have Yaqub ibn Ja'far, and then Qutayba ibn Mihran. And in the seventh place, we have Abu Hayawa Shurayh ibn Yazid. And according to one opinion, this is how it is stated that according to one opinion, he is actually the teacher of Ali ibn Hamza. However, another opinion says that Shurayh was actually a student of Kisai, and he acquired his reading from him. And the last person in this regard is Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hammad. Now, these are the eight teachers about whom we can say that they are the people from whom Hamza acquired his reading or read out to them. But as I said, that they are not presented or they are not supported by any isnad-based content. Now, I would like to describe some more details or describe some more facts regarding these eight teachers who have been discussed in history as the teachers of Ali. But of course, they are not supported or corroborated by any isnad. So, if you recall, the first of them was Ismail ibn Jafar. He's actually Abu Ibrahim Ismail ibn Jafar. So, according to Ibn al-Jazari, Ismail ibn Jafar read out the Quran to Shayba ibn Nisa, Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym, Sulaym ibn Muslim ibn Jammaz, and Isa ibn Wardan. And according to Ibn al-Jazari, Abu Salat Zayda ibn Qudama. And again, he is the person that I just discussed earlier on. He is another teacher of Ali, but this time again, he's not supported through any isnad. And again, what I'm presenting here before you is again some stuff which does not have any corroboration from any isnad. They are just claims by various authorities. So, according to Ibn al-Jazari, As-Salat ibn Zayda ibn Qudama read out the Quran to Al-Amish. On the other hand, Az-Zahabi does not even mention an entry on Zayda ibn Qudama in his Marifat al-Qura al-Kibar. So, although Jazari refers to him, we find Az-Zahabi in his Marifat al-Qura not mentioning him. So, as far as Mufazzal ibn Muhammad al-Dhabi is concerned, he's also another non-Isnad-based teacher, claimed to be a teacher of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai. Ibn al-Jazari says that he read out the Quran to Asim ibn Najud and to Al-Amash. And Az-Zahabi names only Asim to be the person to whom he read out. So, although Ibn al-Jazari says that there were two teachers of Al-Mufazzal ibn Muhammad al-Zabi, one of them was Asim and the other one was Amash. Zahabi, on the contrary, in his Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar, says that he only names one of them, and he is Asim to be the person to whom he read out the Quran. Now, according to Ibn al-Jazari, the fourth person I'm going to discuss is actually Muhammad ibn al-Hasan. It's Muhammad ibn al-Hasan ibn Abi Sara. So, according to Ibn al-Jazari, Muhammad ibn al-Hasan ibn Abi Sara has narrated recitals from Abu Amr ibn al-Ula. But there is no entry on Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad in Zahabi's Marifatul Qurra al-Kibar. So, as far as he is concerned, we do not find any entry. And this, he is also one of the people on whom I had just presented earlier on that he's another teacher. So, once we have discussed Muhammad ibn Hassan, Ibn Hassan al-Ibn Sara, the next person that I have just said is that as far as Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad is concerned, another non-Isnad based teacher of Ali, There is no entry as far as Azhabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar is concerned. Now, another person who was who we spoke of as the teacher, as a non-Isnad-based teacher of Ali ibn Hamza, if you recall, was Yaqub ibn Jafar ibn Kasir. So according to Ibn al-Jazri, he has read out the Quran to Sulaiman ibn Muslim ibn Jammaz and to Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym. But there is no entry on Yaqub ibn Jafar ibn Kasir in Az-Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. So Ibn al-Jazri does say this, but there is no entry in Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. And then viewers, another person that we discussed as a non-Isnad-based teacher of Ali ibn Hamza was Qutaybah ibn Mihran. So according to Ibn al-Jazri, Qutaybah ibn Mihran, besides being a Quran teacher of al-Kisa'i, is also his Quran student. So he has both these distinctions, that he is a teacher as well as a student of Kisa'i. Other teachers of Qutaybah are Sulaiman ibn Muslim ibn Jammaz and Ismail ibn Kasir. And Az-Zahabi only mentions al-Kisa'i as his Quran teacher, on the other hand. Now, another person that we had discussed as the this teacher of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i, a non-Isnad-based teacher, if you recall, he was Abu Hayawa Shurayh ibn Yazid. So according to Ibn al-Jazri, he has narrated qiraat from Abu al-Birhasam, Imran ibn Usman, and from al-Kisa'i, his reading. His son Hayawa has narrated from him his reading and also that of al-Kisa'i. And there is no entry on Abu Hayawa Shurayh ibn Yazid in Az-Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. Now, as far as the last of these is concerned, again, we are discussing the eight non-Isnad-based teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i. And the last of them is Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad. So, according to Ibn al-Jazri, Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad presented his reading to Hamza al-Zayyad and to Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. He has also narrated some recitals of Nafi ibn Abi Nu'aym, Isa ibn Umar, and Shayban, who reports these recitals from Asim. And there is no entry on Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad in Az-Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. And I have also briefly discussed this person as well, Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hamad, slightly earlier also. And exactly telling this information that there is no entry on him as far as Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar is concerned. So viewers, this is a very brief summary of the non-Isnad-based teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i and how they have been reported in our two very famous compendiums on Qiraat literature, and they are obviously Ibn al-Jazri's Ghayatul Nihaya and Zahabi's Marifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. Next, viewers, the thing of note here is that now I'm going to proceed by taking up those teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i who have been reported through some Isnad-based content. Now, let me start off by citing the first narrative before you in this case. And the first of these narratives, viewers, has been cited by Ad-Dani in his Jami' al-Bayan fil Qira' al-Sab'a al-Mashhura. So it says, An Abi Hisham qal Zabat al-Kisa'i al-Qira' ala Hamza, which says that Abu Hisham Muhammad ibn Yazid al-Rafa'i said, al-Kisa'i presented his reading in a sound manner to Hamza. Now, you can see that its chain of narration is being displayed before you. It is a single strand besides another, which actually also tells us vis-a-vis the reading, since this narrative has also been reported by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid. So, Al-Mizzi has recorded the following jar on Abu Hisham, Muhammad ibn Yazid al-Rifa'i. So, you can see he is the basic person who actually reports this fact that Hamza read out that he soundly presented his reading, al-Kisa'i soundly presented his reading to his teacher, Hamza. So we are discussing the first of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i's teacher, and he is Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyad. So as far as the jar on Abu Hisham is concerned, according to An-Nisa'i, and this jar viewers is being quoted or cited from Hafiz Mizzi's Tehzeeb al-Kamal. So, according to Nisa'i, he's Zaif. Bukhari says that he saw authorities unanimously regard him to be Zaif. When people asked Abu Abdurrahman Abdullah ibn Umar about Abu Hisham al-Rifa'i, he expressed his dislike for him. Ibn Numair is reported to have said, he was the weakest amongst us in quest. So, kana az'afuna talaban. And the most abundant in gharaib. Abu Hatim says that he is Zaif and that authorities have expressed jar on him and that he is similar to Masruq ibn Marzuban. Ibn Habban says, Yukhti wa yukhalif. Ibn Hajar's opinion about him is Laysa bil Khawi. Ibn Hajar records Al-Darqutni says that the people of his city regard him negatively. Imam al-Hakim says that authorities regard him to be Laysa bil Qawi. Ad-Dani says that he acquired qiraat from a whole group and would narrate a lot of shuzuz from them in which his companions forsook him. So this is what Ibn Hajar has posited in his Tehzeeb al-Tehzeeb. Now, viewers, let's move on to the second narrative in this regard. And this second narrative also is regarding Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, regarding Hamza to be a teacher of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai. So this narrative has been recorded by Ad-Dani in his Jami al-Bayan fil Qiraat al-Sab'a al-Mashura. And it says, قال حدثني أحمد بن يزيد الحلواني قال قال خلف قال خلف قرأ الكسائي الكسائي على حمزة القرآن أربع مرات. So this narrative is being now displayed before you in the form of a chart, which says that Khalaf ibn Hisham said Al-Kisai read out the Quran to Hamza four times. So the chart of this or the single strand on which this narrative is based can be seen. Besides others, it has been reported by Dani, and this Dani's book, of course, represents this chain of narration as well. The problem with this chain of narration, viewers, is that Ahmad ibn Yazid al-Halwani is a suspect narrator because Abu Zura al-Razi was not pleased with him. So therefore, in this regard, we need to understand that we cannot completely rely on this narrative as well. So this is as far as Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat is concerned. These were the two narratives in which he is depicted as the teacher of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai. Next, we move on to the second category. And this second category of narratives of viewers actually tells us that Aban ibn Taghlab, Hajjaj ibn Artha,
Muhammad ibn Abdir Rahman ibn Abi Layla,
and Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, and Isa ibn Umar. So all these were the teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai. And actually, there is a single narrative which tells so, and this we are now moving to this category. So this narrative has been recorded by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in his Kitab al-Sarba, and it says, قال حدثنا محمد بن سفيان قال قال الكسائي أدركت أشياخ أخشياخ أهل الكوفة القراء الفقهاء, and then he names them ابن أبي ليلى وأبان بن تغلب تغلب وحجاج بن أرثى وعيسى بن عمر الحمزاني وحمزة الزيات. As I said, this narrative is recorded by Abu Bakr ibn Mujahid in his Kitab al-Sarba. So Al-Kisai said, I met the chief reciters and jurists of Kufa, and then he names them Ibn Abi Layla, Aban ibn Taghlib, Al-Hajjaj ibn Artha, Isa ibn Umar, and Hamza al-Zayyat. Of course, this is referring to Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat. Now you can see the chain of narration of this narrative being displayed before you. The first important thing, viewers, which is of note and which we must note, is that the above narrative does not even explicitly mention the fact that Kisai read out the Quran to reciters he met and named. The words that have been used are adrakto ashyakha ahlil kufa, that I met these shuyukh of ahlil kufa, or obviously it has to be implied, taken as an implication or an insinuation that he read out the Quran to them or heard them reading the Quran. But this has not been explicitly mentioned, so this is a point of note. Now, as far as Muhammad ibn Sufyan ibn Wirdan is concerned, you can see that he is being indicated in the chart. Ibn Habban says, Yukhti wa Yahim. He makes mistakes and also errs. Ibn Hajar records that Maslama ibn Qasim said, I heard the Ahlul Hadith say that this person is Zaif, and they were of the opinion that he is a liar, so I abandoned him. So therefore, this is important to note that we can clearly see that as far as these teachers are concerned, in the presence of Sufyan ibn Wirdan, the way he has been reported as a liar, we cannot rely on information that is posited about them or given about them. Next, let us move on to the next narrative in this regard, and this is recorded. And this actually tells us that Muhammad ibn Abdir Rahman ibn Abi Layla was a teacher of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisai. This, and in this regard also, we just have a single. In fact, let me correct myself. This third narrative actually tells us that Muhammad ibn Abdir Rahman ibn Layla, Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat, Isa ibn Umar, and Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. So these are the people who are regarded in this third narrative to be the teachers of Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyad. And this narrative, viewers, has been cited by Adani in his Jami' al-Bayan. Let me read this narrative before you. It says, حدثنا فارس بن أحمد قال حدثنا عبد الباقي بن الحسن قال حدثنا أحمد بن مسلم الحنبلي قال قري على أحمد بن رستم وأنا أسمع حدثكم نسير بن يوسف قال قرأت على الكسائي فأخبرني أنه قرأ القرآن كله على حمزة بن حبيب الزيات وعلى جماعة في أسر حمزة منهم ابن أبي ليلى وعيسى بن عمر Al-Hamadani wa Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. So just summarizing this chain of narration, Isnad, I'm going to read it from Nusair. So Nusair ibn Yusuf said, I read out the Quran to Al-Kisa'i. So he informed me that he read out the whole of the Quran to Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat and to a group which belonged to the age of Hamza. So the era of Hamza. And among them were Ibn Abi Layla, Isa ibn Umar, and Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. So you can see that it's chain of narration is being displayed before you. The problem, viewers, in this chain of narration is that no tawseek is available on
Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Muslim al-Hambali.
You can see that his name is being displayed before you, but we do not find that
Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Muslim al-Hambali.
We do not find any tawseek on him, in fact. So, according to Khatib Baghdadi, only one person, Ali ibn Ahmad ibn Sulaiman al-Misri, narrates from him. This is a further problem. And so therefore, if a single person narrates from a person, then he is consigned to the category of Majhul al-Ayn. So he is Majhul al-Ayn. And perhaps this is the reason why neither he is mentioned by Az-Zahabi in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar, nor by Ibn al-Jazari in his Ghayat al-Nihaya. So none of them mention him. But the problem is that in his presence, so in the presence of
Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Muslim al-Hambali,
in the absence of any tawseek on him, and also this further information that he is a Majhul al-Ayn person because a single person narrates from him, and also the fact that two primary works like Zahabi's Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar and Ibn al-Jazri's Ghayat al-Nihaya do not mention him, this actually severely makes impugns this narrative and makes it absolutely unreliable. So, viewers, we can clearly see that the six teachers which have been reported by Isnad in this regard through Isnad based content, none of this Isnad based content can be relied upon. So, the six teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i who have been reported by Isnad based content were Aban ibn Taghlib, Al-Hajjaj ibn Artha. Then in the third place we have Muhammad ibn Abdirrahman ibn Abi Layla. In the fourth place we have Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat. Then in the fifth was Isa ibn Umar al-Hamadani. And in the sixth place was Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. So in this case also we can see that all these six teachers are not, they cannot be reliably regarded to be the teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i because of the weakness in the Isnad, which report them as the teachers of Ali. So viewers, now I'm going to give some further information regarding the teachers, regarding these six teachers which I have just discussed of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i, who are the Isnad-based teachers. And this information is also something of an interest that would tell us furthermore about these six Isnad-based teachers. So it may be noted that Ibn al-Jazri does not mention Aban ibn Taghlib among the Quran teachers of al-Kisa'i in his entry on al-Kisa'i, nor does he mention al-Kisa'i as a Quran student of Aban ibn Taghlib in his biographical entry on the latter. So neither in the entry of Aban ibn Taghlib nor in the entry of al-Kisa'i are both these two mentioned as teachers and students to one another. So this is what Zahabi has posited regarding Aban ibn Taghlib. Now similarly, Zahabi, this is what actually Ibn al-Jazari has posited. Now as far as Zahabi is concerned, he also does not mention Aban ibn Taghlib as a Quran teacher of al-Kisa'i, though a narrative he records says that al-Kisa'i met him. Neither does he give an independent entry on Aban ibn Taghlib in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. So this is also a strange thing that Zahabi does not even record him, give him an independent entry in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. So this was as far as Aban ibn Taghlib is concerned. Also, viewers, that point to note is regarding Al-Hajjaj ibn Artha. So it is strange that Ibn al-Jazri neither mentions Al-Hajjaj ibn Artha among the Quran teachers of Al-Kisa'i in his biographical entry on Al-Kisa'i, And even more strange that he does not mention Al-Hajjaj's biographical entry. So this is he does not even mention Hajjaj's biographical entry. Similarly, Zahabi in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar does not mention Hajjaj ibn Artha as a Quran teacher of al-Kisa'i, though a narrative record says that al-Kisa'i met him. Neither does he give an independent entry on Hajjaj ibn Artha in his Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar. So the reason that I'm citing this information is that we can see how clearly the paucity of evidence that these people who have been regarded to be the teachers earlier from the Ibn Hazar al-Kisa'i, some of them are not even recorded. So, and the, even glaring is the fact that independent entries against their names also do not exist in these two primary works of Qira'at. Now, Ibn al-Jazri in his biographical note on al-Kisa'i mentions Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash to be a Quran teacher of al-Kisa'i. However, in his biographical note on Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, he specifies that al-Kisa'i never read out the Quran to Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash. He only narrates certain readings or recitals from him. So this is another important point to note. Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash is in his biographical, this is Ibn al-Jazri in his biographical note on Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash says that, specifies that, that al-Kisa'i never read out the Quran to him. And again, as I said, this is something of very important that we must note all these things. So this was as far as some information is concerned regarding these three teachers, and all these three teachers were those who were actually Isnad-based teachers. But this further information tells us how weakly they have been reported as teachers of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i. So viewers, if I sum up the narratives which record Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i's teachers, you can see that the chart that is being displayed before you, this chart actually displays his teachers and also the teachers of his teachers. But if my critique is accepted, then this chart is reduced to nothing, as you can see, because none of Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i's teachers, the six teachers which I just described before you, can be established through Isnad-based content. So this is as far as Ali ibn Hamza al-Kisa'i's Isnad or his canonical readings is concerned. Inshallah, we shall take up the remaining two reciters in the coming episodes before we glance or take a panoramic view of all these readings and then finally come to a conclusion. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ